I began writing about the Vietnam War about 7 years ago, and what has surprised me time and again is that the cliche that the victors write the history does not apply in the Vietnam War. We have not, we as Australians, have certainly not allowed the Viet Cong, the North Vietnamese government, to colour in any way our view of what happened in the war or its aftermath. It's quite strange. Australia has its own unique story about the Vietnam War. That's not true. There are several perspectives on the Vietnam War from uniquely Australian viewpoints, and one of them, which I've heard from veterans, is that Australia actually did win the Vietnam War. That was at a conference of the Victorian Military History Society. The guy's argument was that there were three Vietnam Wars, as I understand it. It's quite difficult to reconstruct his argument. Three Indochinese wars. The first one was the Vietnamese versus the French, which, he agreed the Vietnamese won. The second one was the Vietnamese versus the Australians, which we won. And the third one was the Vietnamese versus the Americans. So that, the interpretation and reinterpretation of history never ends. And in this case, certainly in Australia, we've allowed or permitted or invited our veterans to some extent to write their own story about the war, which has the Australian contribution at its centre, and what supposedly happened to a large number of veterans in the aftermath of the war as the kind of punchline in a, this sounds ludicrous, punchline in a morality play doesn't make sense because, of course, morality plays don't have punchlines. But certainly brings to the fore not any damage that Australia might have done to the Vietnamese, but the damage that the war itself had on the Australians who pursued it against the Viet Cong, North Vietnamese, however you want to characterize the major enemy in the Vietnam War. There's quite a lot of ideological argument about how Australia came to be involved in the Vietnam War. And there's this idea that, we were dragged in on the coattails of the Americans. But current research and, the dominant ideas, I think, among respectable military historians is that we invited ourselves in, we wanted to be in the Vietnam War, not because of any particular axe to grind with the government of North Vietnam, although the Menzies government of North Vietnam and the government of North Vietnam didn't have a great deal in common. But we wanted to keep America as a policeman in Southeast Asia because we'd seen how the UK, Britain, as a policeman, its role had fallen apart after Suez and even before that, when it became clear that Britain couldn't defend Singapore in the Second World War. So we wanted America here in our region, if you call Vietnam our region, as a great power, as a strong military power, and we were prepared to do whatever we could to keep them here, including commit troops to Vietnam. Two hundred people, 200 different opinions. There were strands of, I suppose, collected wisdom, collected experience that you could pull out. Like a lot of people, a lot of veterans did refer to the treatment that they received after the war. A lot of veterans did talk about being spat on, about having blood poured on them. They'd couch this generally in fairly similar terms. They'd say, we got spat on, we got blood poured over us. And at first I thought they meant themselves, or they and their friends, or anybody in any way connected with them, or somehow connected with them, I suppose. But they didn't. They meant Vietnam veterans as a whole. That's not true. A couple of people I spoke to did say I got spat on, but it was always an unverifiable incident. Another person, one of the 200 or so, said I got blood thrown on me, but the incident he described was impossible. But mainly they were talking about an idea that, as I say, collectively they had been spat upon. And even the spit was more of a metaphor than an actual spit. It was the idea, I came to believe that was a way of them expressing the idea that their service had been spat upon, that their service was mocked, their service was not valued by the wider society. But that wasn't, that certainly wasn't the only perspective. A lot of people were welcomed back to their communities with open arms. A lot of people had no stories of rejection. A lot of people of either personal rejection or a broader social rejection. And there were people for, it's bizarre how central to the Australian narrative, the homecoming is, because name another war where that's held to be the important part. Who knows what happened to the First World War veterans when they came home? Who gives a damn what happened to Korean War veterans when they came home? Which isn't to say nobody should care, but I've rarely heard it raised. But with some Vietnam veterans, that becomes the whole story. But for other veterans, it's not part of the story at all. They talk about their time in the army, and then their time. I didn't specifically ask them about their life afterwards anyway. I was writing a book about the war years. So there are similarities in the narratives of some Vietnam veterans. But I should also say, I only interviewed former National Servicemen. I have interviewed a handful, more than a handful, maybe less than 20 regular soldiers from the Vietnam War era. And they had different perspectives on almost everything. And their experience of homecoming was quite different from that of national servicemen, because most of them stayed in the army at least immediately and simply returned to their units, whereas many national servicemen were, in their own, in the way it looked to them, just left to make their way in the world. So there's many different stories. There are different national servicemen, different veterans, and there's a divide in the stories of national servicemen and regular soldiers, and indeed of officers and men, and possibly even Jews and non-Jews, because, that's an important point. Well, I don't think very many Jewish people from Australia went to Vietnam. It's very difficult to quantify. The first study of Jews and the Vietnam War, probably the only one really, was by Philip Mendes, and he was talking about Jews who were opposed to the Vietnam War. And he reckoned, I can't remember, I think he might have identified three Jewish veterans at the time. I found and spoke to, but found because I was looking for, spoke to about a dozen, I think, in the end. And again, their stories were all different. I don't think you could claim that the Australian Army was a hotbed of anti-Semitism. I think, again, what was overlooked, what is often overlooked is the philo-Semitism of military establishments. You know, in the West, the military establishment loves Israel, you know, and that's what it equates Jews with. And, you know, it's a professional force. They've even got conscription. You know, they're always winning their wars, very well equipped, very disciplined, got the whole population behind them. When the officer training during the Vietnam War, or the late stages of the Vietnam War, they would learn about the Six-Day War, you know. So the Jews had a contradictory image in the army, and you've got a legacy of Monash, but I don't think that really played any great part. But yeah, some people faced anti-Semitism that I spoke to. Generally, it was casual anti-Semitism. Often, it would be difficult to distinguish it from, you know, simple bullying, I suppose. And there was a lot of bullying, deliberate bullying that goes on in basic training with a clear objective. It's not just irrational. And I don't think perhaps the corporals understood the difference about bullying somebody because they were Jewish between that and bullying somebody because they didn't like their haircut until such time as their haircut quickly disappeared. But, you know, there were times, but I don't think any more than in broader Australian society.
I might just get you to elaborate on one thing that you talked about, talked about most of the Jews that had anything to do with the war were against it. Now, did that then in any way affect the reception of the Jewish soldiers that came back? If the community was sort of anti the war, did you find any evidence of that claim?
No, I didn't actually say that. I said Philip Mendes studied Jewish people who were part of the anti-war movement. I would guess that there were more Jewish people in the anti-war movement than there were in the army, but there were very specific, there were Jewish students, there were Jewish socialists, there were the heirs of the Bundists. They were not the official Jewish community. The official established Jewish community, they liked the Vietnam War, you know? They were all for giving a boot to communism. They were all for having America in Southeast Asia. Jewish radicalism is always talked up by historians and by, you know, Jewish radicals. But the truth is, you know, the majority of the community has always been conservative. Not necessarily authoritarian conservative, but certainly conservatives as in, you know, they want to keep their head down, they want to let things lie, they want to be safe, they want to be accepted. They don't want to be shouting about a war in Southeast Asia. And as usual, they're sort of conservative. The conservative Jewish masses sort of get written out of history in the same way that the conservative non-Jewish masses who supported the Vietnam War, who supported conscription, are never heard from these days, never heard of these days. Now, as to reception back in the community, it wasn't an issue with anybody I spoke to, a reception back in the Jewish community. There was, what did surprise me though, was two of the Jewish veterans I found, which I suppose must mean I found 14, were actually converts who had converted after the war. I'm no idea why that should be the case, because there are, you know, they weren't, I was only talking National Service veterans. There aren't many of them anyway, there's only about 16,000. There aren't many Jewish people. And you know, there's not a large number of convicts converts to Judaism in Australia, but two of them are Vietnam veterans. And I guess that must show how unspurned, how not spurned that veterans are by the Jewish community, in that we're sort of, you know, well, I wouldn't say they were recruited, but they were certainly accepted, even when they weren't Jewish to begin with. No, I think statues are more important than people. it seems to be the consensus in the conservative establishment at the moment anyway. So yeah, what we need is like really, really big statues of dead people and no money for the living who really made their own bed, you know. No, I mean, of course, it's ludicrous to spend money commemorating the dead of wars gone by rather than consoling the relatives of the bereaved, rather than consoling the bereaved, or help or put money into veterans services, helping people readjust to life after the army, which is a huge thing. Like, we hear a lot about post-traumatic stress syndrome, but not so much about the sort of institutionalization, I suppose, that happens to blokes when they're in the army, and the difficulty of readjusting. You know, there a large number of soldiers are in the infantry, and that's not a transferable skill. You know, nobody joins the infantry to learn a trade. You know, they want to shoot people and blow stuff up, and really the opportunities to do that in civilian life are essentially limited. So I think, yeah, obviously the money that is spent, I mean, I'm not against the John Monash Centre at all, the Sir John Monash Centre. You know, I went on a junket there. I'm certainly in favour of that happening. I'll go back tomorrow if you're allowed to go to France. But obviously care for the living is more important.